been a wizard for the last two holes of getting up and down. And look at this.
The man in black, just like Gary Player, whose name is on the trophy all those years ago. Nathan Holman, at 24 years of age, has his biggest moment in golf.
Just under 70 yards left for Adam Scott. That's right. It went straight down the tubes.
Oh, it's made wonderful shot of it. What a delivery from Michael Long. Sensational shot.
Gentlemen, welcome to the PGA Night of Nights, the 2016 Greg Norman Medal.
Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening. If I could ask those standing, if you would be so kind as to take your seats, as distinguished guests all, welcome to the Royal Pines here on the Gold Coast, and welcome to the Greg Norman Medal dinner for 2016. There is indeed an all-star cast who've gathered here this evening, from the players to the professionals to the senior players and the junior players who form the basis of the future of golf in this country. We've got a big night ahead, culminating in the announcement, of course, of the winner of the most prestigious Greg Norman Medal for 2016. To open proceedings, would you join with me in welcoming the CEO of the PGA of Australia, Mr. Brian Thorburn.
To the Right Honourable Lord Mayor of the Gold Coast, Tom Tate, Lady Mayoress Ruth Tate, Chairman of the PGA, Peter O'Malley, PGA Directors, life members of the PGA, PGA members, our tournament professionals, our sponsors and commercial partners, the Chairwoman of the ALPG, Shani Waugh, CEO of Golf Australia, Stephen Pitt, industry colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 2016 Greg Norman Medal Dinner, our professional golf's night of nights, our second edition here at the wonderful RACV Royal Pines Resort. Last year was our very special inaugural dinner, and this year promises to be even better. Tonight is about celebrating great achievement by members of the PGA and the ALPG. We celebrate achievement in training and development through our PGA Trainee of the Year Award. We celebrate great achievement by our PGA vocational members at golf clubs right across our country through the Club Pro and Teaching Pro awards. And I'm delighted to confirm that the winners of those awards will henceforth be winning a prize of a fully funded trip to the PGA of America Coaching Summit and Merchandise Show in the United States. We celebrate achievement on the golf course through our Men's and Ladies Domestic Player of the Year awards. And we introduced for the first time in 2016 recognition of the achievement of our seniors through the Legends Player of the Year Award. A highlight tonight will be our celebration of lifetime achievement through our new and prestigious PGA Immortal Award, where we recognise those members, PGA members, who have left an indelible mark on golf in our country. And lastly, we will celebrate achievement on the world stage through our Greg Norman Medal Award for the best male or female Australian player competing on the world's tours. We're in for a great night, and I just want to thank the Gold Coast Council for again supporting our Greg Norman Medal Dinner, to Mayor Tom Tate, Your council is a great partner of this event, both the Greg Norman Medal Dinner and the PGA Championship. You're a great friend of the PGA and a great ambassador for the Gold Coast. Can you put your hands together for Tom Tate and Gold Coast Council? But tonight is only the entree to our week of golfing wonder. The main course starts on Thursday with the PGA Championship, and this year we're bigger and better than 2015. We've got a very strong field competing for the Kirkwood Cup. We welcome back world number 7 Adam Scott, as well as Mark Leishman, John Sendon, Olympians Marcus Fraser and Scott Hend, Rod Pampling and many others, including former champions from 2014 and 15, Greg Chalmers and Nathan Holman. Plus Ian Poulter, Harold Varner III, major winner Wai Yang and a host of others from the European Tour. Off the golf course, our team at the PGA have again strived to expand the festival feel of the tournament, and we've got better entertainment in the village each night this week, with Shannon Knoll headlining Saturday night's concert. We've got better facilities at the Sonic Million Dollar Hole, hole in one, where again $1 million will be up for grabs. We've introduced free shuttle buses from Broadbeach Station South and Jupiter's Casino. Plus, I'm delighted to tell you, with divine intervention, we arranged a fantastic weather outlook with the forecast for 31 to 33 degrees sunshine for Thursday through Sunday. Not a bad effort there from the team. Lastly, I'd just like to thank all of our commercial partners, Tourism and Events Queensland, Gold Coast Council, RACV, Emirates, APN, Coca-Cola, Sonic, Tag Heuer, Liberty, Kumho Tyres and Lexus. And that roll call of sponsors is a reflection of the attraction of this tournament. It's a reflection of the commitment and support and trust our commercial partners have in the PGA Championship. And again, we'd like to thank all of our sponsors and partners for their support. Put your hands together, please. While I'm on the subject of commercial partners, our broadcaster, the Seven Network, and production partner, European Tour Productions, deserve special mention. The Seven Network, this is the third week in a row that they've broadcast top quality golf around Australia. They're a great partner, Australia's number one network, and we'd like to thank them for their support and their commitment to golf. Together, we've got a great team. We've got a great dinner coming up here tonight. We've got a great championship starting on Thursday. Thanks again for everyone for all of your support, and we hope that you enjoy tonight. Thank you.
Brian, thank you, and what better place to be than the Gold Coast for this outstanding tournament? To that end, would you please welcome the Mayor of the City of the Gold Coast, Mr. Tom Tate, to say a few words.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. I want to acknowledge Peter O'Malley, Chairman of PGA Australia, and Adam Scott. He's also our winner of the City of the Gold Coast, Key to the City. And of course, we'll be out there barracking for him, but anyone who's a winner, you know, Gold Coasters, we love sport, and we'll be barracking, and we'll be celebrating whoever takes out the tournament. And Peter Thompson, PGA Life member, my council colleagues. Well, I've known Brian Thorburn since the days when they had dinosaurs on golf courses, or on the golf course. And I reflect since those days, and that this is the fourth year the Australian PGA's come to the Gold Coast. And I have to say that you've met every expectation and more for our city. First up, RACV upgraded their golf course to world standards, that it really is a destination for golfers right around the world to come and play here as well. On top of that, apart from all the major golfers, you look at the fields that this golf course that you have attracted. It's been phenomenal. And you also announced the European Tour sanction. It means that the forecast gets beamed to 400 million households throughout Europe. And all that wasn't part of the deal. And that's what the Australian PGA has brought to the city of the Gold Coast. And together with Channel 7, I love the bit that any time I get out and say hello to Paddy Walsh, always welcoming. And I look forward to working with Channel 7 as we march towards the Commonwealth Games, as they'd be the designated television channel. So all in all, tonight's Greg Norman medal. I'm not sure Greg didn't make it here in life tonight. Is it what I said about his shoulder? Last time there was a lot of pain, but I was just joking at the time and I said, I won't repeat what I said, but I thought it was funny. But I know how busy Greg is, and I'm sure he'll be, he's here in spirit. And enjoy tonight, and enjoy the whole festive of the whole 4 days of golf on the Gold Coast. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is time to resume proceedings here at the Greg Norman Medal for 2016. And we open with our national awards announcements. And each presenter will be announcing the winner. Well, the nominees and the details of the nominees are listed indeed in your program. And to present the first two awards tonight, would you welcome the PGA Vice Chairman, Mr. David Stretton.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to present the Trainee of the Year. As awarded by the PGA Academy and Vocational Council, the 2016 National Trainee of the Year is Luke Blemick from Rosanna Golf Club in Victoria.
Third-year PGA trainee Luke Blemick from Victoria has been awarded the 2016 Trainee of the Year by the PGA of Australia. Blemick has completed his traineeship under the tutelage of Richard Cooney, the head professional at Rosanna Golf Club. Throughout this year, Blemick has maintained a distinction average in all of his academic study areas, including coaching, game development, small business and management. On the playing front, the 31-year-old finished the year with a final scoring average of minus 0.05 under par, nationally ranking him 6th out of 260 trainees this year. The Victorian has won 5 trainee events this year, as well as a victory on the PGA Pro-Am Series. Throughout his traineeship, Luke has been incredibly consistent and has held the honour of being the Victorian trainee captain for 2015 and 2016.
It's now my pleasure to present the Club Professional of the Year. The 2016 State Club Professionals of the Year form a list of nominees for the PGA National title, and those nominees are Ryan and Janelle Smith from New South Wales from the Charlestown Golf Club, Tim Porter from Queensland from Victoria Park Golf Club, Ian Pritchard from South Australia from the Mount Osmond Golf Club, Zach Rollins from Tasmania from the Seabrook Golf Club, Scott Baradell from Victoria from the Eastern Golf Club, and Troy Murphy from Western Australia from Capel Golf Club. And it's my pleasure to announce the Club Professional of the Year, or National Club Professional of the Year, is Ryan and Janelle Smith from Charlestown Golf Club.
He Paid professionals at Charlestown Golf Club, Ryan and Janelle Smith never stop trying to improve their club and focus strongly on servicing their club members to the best of their collective abilities on a daily basis. One of their main goals was to gradually have members become more involved with club activities, in particular ladies events and the club's successful My Golf Junior program. During the year, their communication to members and staff has been beneficial to the club through newsletters, promotions, and social media. Dedicated to their ongoing professional development, they also ran a highly successful Holden Scramble in 2016.
Congratulations, guys. David, thank you for joining us here tonight with the first two awards of the Greg Norman Medal of 2016. I'm now going to invite PGA board member, Mr. Bruce Green, to join us to present the next award.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The nominations for the Teaching Professional of the Year are Jason Laws from New South Wales, Newcastle Golf Club. Richard Woodhouse from Queensland, KDV Sport Academy of Golf. Anne-Marie Knight, South Australia, Adelaide Shores Golf Club. Bryce Gorman, Tasmania, Prospect Vale Country Club of Tasmania. Matthew Cleverton from Victoria, Kingston Heath Golf Club, and Brad Parker, West Australia, from the Wembley Golf Complex. And the winner is Richard Woodhouse, KCV Golf Academy.
Is the renowned director of instruction at the recently opened KDV Sport Academy of Golf in Queensland, where he works successfully with both amateur golfers and tournament professionals. After winning his first Queensland Teaching Professional of the Year award in 2013, Woodhouse also received the honour in 2015. Amongst his best students are two PGA Tour China players, James Ghibellini and Daniel Nisbet, who recently won the Clearwater Bay Open. In addition to coaching success with a number of South Korean female professionals, also amongst his passions is the coaching of PGA trainee professionals. And in 2015, he assisted Rick Coleman significantly, leading to Coleman being awarded the 2015 PGA National Trainee of the Year. Woodhouse always strives for self-development through continuing education and also writes for various publications, such as Inside Golf and Golf Australia magazine, where he composed a series of 8 months of instructional articles.
Congratulations, young man. Bruce, thank you for joining us here tonight.
I'm very honoured to be joined at the Greg Norman Medal with our 2016 Teaching Professional of the Year, Richard Woodhouse. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. Yeah, it's an honour to receive this and to be alongside a lot of other great coaches that were also finalists. It's a great honour.
And were you surprised that you won the award? Did you have a little inkling that you might take it out this evening?
No, I was definitely surprised to win it. My players had a very, very good year last year, so, it was definitely a surprise, for sure, yeah.
Touching on your players, at the Australian PGA Championship this week, one of your players, James Ghibellini, Monday qualified into the tournament. Must be proud with the progress that he's made this year.
Yeah, he's made great progress. He had a good season up in China, Him and alongside Dan Nisbet, who's also playing this week, who won up at the Clearwater Bay Open in China last week. Both guys have a great opportunity to perform well this week. And alongside the other player, I have Brett Rankin in this week as well, who's coming off the back of some nice form also.
I know that you're very much into the health and fitness side of golf. Can you talk us through your approach there?
Yeah, sure. We measure everything at our facility. We do a lot of 3D testing, and we use TrackMan, a lot of good technology as well. And I'm lucky enough to have a good team of people around me. Ryan Gammon's our athletic director, so I work very closely with him and trying to create good athletic performance. Yeah.
You also coach a lot of amateur golfers. It's not just the professional level. What are the key kind of differences that you need to work with, that takes to work with an amateur as compared to with a professional?
Yeah, with amateurs, we're trying to create good processes. So a lot of just even simple things, learning how to practice correctly and how to address what issues they have and simplify it down. So trying to make it a little less complicated for the amateurs is definitely a big part of what we do.
All right, now it's been a big year for you. You've obviously won the award this evening, but you've also opened a new facility. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. We've opened KDV Sport. We've been running for the last 5 years, but the new facility's just opened 6 months ago. Gorgeous facility. We have a driving undercover driving ranges, along with amazing teaching facilities, gym on site as well, short game facility. So it's definitely one of the best facilities I've ever been to. And yeah, we're excited to see how the players are responding to it and see what we can create in the near future.
All right, Richard. Well, we'll let you go. Congratulations again, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the evening. Ryan and Janelle Smith, and they're our Teaching Professionals of the Year this year, a dynamic husband-wife duo. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Can you tell me how special it is to win this award as husband and wife?
Oh, it's amazing. Like, we honestly didn't think that we would be a chance. There's so many good club pros out there, but yeah, very honoured. So thank you very much.
Yeah, I think it's just great to do something that we love and do it together. And we really enjoy what we do.
Okay, now I hear that you have an excellent junior program. You run the My Golf Junior program. Can you talk me through how many juniors you have with you and what kind of things you're doing with them day to day, week to week?
Yeah, so we run a free beginner My Golf program on a Tuesday afternoon. And a couple of weeks ago, we had 35 juniors turn up. So they're like new kids to the game, which is what we're most passionate about. We do a lot of work with Jack Newton Junior Golf in New South Wales. That's where sort of I came through the ranks playing golf. And whatever we can give back to junior golf is amazing to us. That's sort of what we try and do. And then we have like a advanced program on a Friday, which we have a few kids as well, and a development program. And Ryan does a lot with a couple of kids that are involved in the New South Wales team and national teams in Blake Windred and Jai Picken. So we've got a lot of really good kids coming through, and it's awesome. Love it.
Ryan, can you talk us through the work that you do with your elite amateurs and the state teams?
Yeah, we've been lucky. Picked up a few young kids when we first started there 6 years ago, and I've coached them all the way through now, and they're in some elite teams. And yeah, they're just great kids, great atmosphere for juniors at our club. I really thank our club a lot. They really accommodate the juniors well, like them to play with the members. And yeah, we've just been very lucky with a great golf club.
Now, also I hear that you have a big focus on the lady members. Being a lady club pro yourself, do you feel like that puts you in a unique position to try and grow the game amongst women?
Yeah, definitely. And we are really lucky at our club. We have Joanna Mantle, who's our manager, and Jo used to be a touring pro as well. So she knows a lot about women's golf, and she supports us in what we do. So we've just developed a new ladies beginner membership within the club, and we're hoping to grow that and get some younger people in the game.
Yeah. All right. Excellent. Well, I congratulate you both. I'll let you go and enjoy your evening, and congratulations once again.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
That's great.
And I'm joined now by Luke Blumink, our 2016 Trainee Professional of the Year. Luke, congratulations.
Thank you.
And now, can you tell me how excited you were to learn that you were going to receive this award tonight? Obviously, there's a lot of fantastic trainees going through the program.
Yeah, it was a bit of a shock, to be honest. I thought I was in trouble when Jeff rang me, because it's not usually a good phone call, but yeah, very excited. It was good.
Now, you must have had some sort of inkling that you might be in the running. Obviously, you had an excellent playing average, and you have also done great in your academic studies, so surely couldn't have been too big of a surprise.
I didn't even know it existed, to be honest. I knew the state ones existed, but I didn't actually know the Australian one existed. So, yeah, it was definitely a bit of a shock, yeah.
Well, that's very exciting then, to be joined in the room tonight by so many successful players and members of the PGA and on the Greg Norman Medal Night.
Yeah, it is. There's a lot of good players in this room, and yeah, you have to pinch yourself sometimes when you're around players like Scotty and things like that. So, yeah, it's very exciting.
Now, can you talk us through what you go through during your three-year traineeship and, I guess, the stresses involved and the time management skills and things like that that you need to learn?
Definitely challenging. We had a kid in my second year as well, so, he's nearly two now, so that's taking up a lot of my time. Full-time work, schoolwork, finding time in your personal life, playing. I don't need to practice too much to get through the playing, so that makes it easier. But yeah, definitely got to juggle your time well.
Now, you just mentioned that you don't need to practice too much. You did used to play on tour before you undertook your traineeship. I guess what caused the shift in direction there?
I probably got a little bit burnt out, a little bit overplaying, I suppose. And it was definitely a path, and I had Richard Cooney to thank, my boss. I spoke to him about what I might do and he suggested it. So yeah, went down that path.
Now, the secret to having a successful PGA traineeship is obviously an excellent PGA mentor. You've just mentioned your boss there. Can you tell us what it was like to work with him?
Yeah, it's really good. We've got a great team at Rosanna. Everyone down there is really good, really supportive. Richard's great, gives us time off whenever we need it. We all work as a team, so it works really well.
Now, are you excited to let the members at Rosanna know that you've won the award this evening?
Yeah, I think a few might have leaked out to a couple of them, I think. But yeah, it'd be good to let everyone know, because they're all a part of it as well. So,
now, can you talk to us about how you got involved in golf, and I guess what was your inspiration and who inspired you to continue with the game as you're growing up?
I didn't really play golf at all as a kid, but then my dad's a keen golfer and he said, "Oh, why don't you try it one day?" And I did, and he didn't realise I was left-handed, but I flipped the club over and hit it left-handed anyway, so I've got my dad to thank for a lot of that, yeah.
Okay, and now that you've completed your traineeship, what are your career directions? Where do you want to go with your career in golf?
At the moment, I'll be staying on at Rosanna. I quite like the golf admin side. I'm working a couple of days in the office at Rosanna now, so we'll see where that takes us.
All right, excellent. Well, congratulations once again, Luke, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the evening.
Thank you.
We're joined now by Adam Blythe. Adam is one of our nominees for the 2016 PGA Tour of Australasia Player of the Year. Adam, an exciting evening.
It is. It's fantastic. You know, there's a lot of great turnout and very important, influential people here. It's great to see that with, you know, this event kicking off and everyone getting involved in the PGA.
All right, now let's talk through your season. You started off at the Vic Open and I think you were leading heading into the final round and things didn't go quite to plan.
Yeah, it was a great learning curve. I was leading by three going into the final round and I just kind of fell apart in a sense. My game didn't turn up, probably tried too hard. But it was a fantastic learning curve for the rest of the year and I really took it on board.
Yeah, you certainly did. Later on in the year, you got your first win on tour with us at the South Pacific Open. It was in a playoff with one of your good friends, Jake McLeod. How special was that moment?
It was really special. I mean, it's always hard when you beat someone who's played very well as well, like Jake did, and he could have deserved the event as much as I did. But luckily enough, you know, I hung in there and he'll learn from that just like I did, and he'll win many more.
Now, it wasn't long after that that you won your very next tournament at the New South Wales Open. A far more convincing win, but let's go back to the first two rounds where you had your beautiful girlfriend, Nicole, on the bag.
Yes, yeah, that was really special. It was a special week, to be honest. I asked the girlfriend to come down and caddy, thinking she may be able to pull the buggy. And she had a very big bag to carry, but she wasn't able to pull. She had to carry and she really gutsed it out and got through, and then my dad took over on the final 2 days. So and I got the win, my first time with my dad, but also with my girlfriend. So it was a real special week and a real team effort.
Now, your dad caddies for you full-time usually. Yeah. I know that you play 9 holes every afternoon together. Yeah. So walking down that 18th, can you just talk us through the emotions that were running through and just how special that exact moment was for the two of you?
Well, it would have been longer, even amateur days, just dreaming about it, thinking about it. You know, like my dad always puts pressure on me in a good way at 9 holes, saying, okay, you've got to birdie one of the last three to win the tournament, or you've got to par the last three. So we put a lot of scenarios together, and for many years it never really, you know, came to fruition. But we just love the game, and we knew that it would happen if we just kept at it. And as hard as some of those 12 years were not getting the win, that one moment just made up for everything, and it was just a special, special kind of moment I'll never forget. Hopefully we can do it again, but I'll never forget it. It was amazing.
Now, you're the only player on tour to have had 2 wins this year. You must be feeling quietly confident of taking out the award this evening.
Yeah, it's... I am. You know, it's 2 wins is pretty special. But the other guys have played so well as well in big events. And, you know, it can go either way. I think all of us deserve the win, you know. But, you know, I'm very happy to just be here in the company of everyone here and get nominated and kind of, I guess, get recognised for the year that I've had. And the trophy would just be a bonus.
All right, well, we'll let you go back and enjoy the rest of your evening. Good luck this evening, and best wishes with the Australian PGA Championship as well.
Thank you very much. It's going to be a great night.
And I'm joined here now by Matthew Griffin, another one of our 2016 PGA Tour of Australasia Player of the Year nominees. Matt also is our Order of Merit leader heading into the final tournament of the Australian PGA Championship this week. Can you tell us, Matt, what an Order of Merit win would mean?
An Order of Merit win would be huge. It's getting the start in the Open and a few other World Golf Championships really opens the doors to some other golf for us, the players that play in Australia.
Now, it's been quite a tightly run battle between yourself and Mike Hendry. We've got another couple of players coming through as well this week that could perhaps take it. It's really been a goal of yours this year, hasn't it?
It has, yeah. I really, once I won New Zealand, I changed my schedule around a bit more to fit in Fiji and play as many as I could back home. So it'd be, if we can finally close it out this week, it'd be great.
Chasing that Order of Merit victory, you've had to give up some big tournaments on the Japan Tour where you also play full-time, but you did seal up your card for next year as well.
Yeah, it was. I only did it just, so it was a bit nail-biting there at the end, but played well enough in the last week to keep my status for next year, which is really positive.
Now, you haven't played a huge amount of tournaments at home this year due to the Japan Tour, but you are nominated for the Player of the Year award tonight. That must be a special feeling.
It is. I guess as a kid, I grew up watching the Australian Tour and wishing that I could play on the PGA Tour of Australasia. So to be able to be nominated to win an award like this is a really a great honour and something would have been pretty cool if I'd known that 20 years ago.
Now, the Australian PGA Championship this week, obviously there's a lot riding on it. What time do you tee off on Thursday? Who are you playing alongside?
11:45, playing with Wade Ormsby and Jordan Zunick, so a good group. And Hopefully the wind's not up too much and we can get out there and have a good couple of days. It's a tough, tough course, so just plug away and hopefully make a few birdies.
Yeah, I was just about to touch on the course. What do you think of the Graham Marsh redesign? And you've played it before, haven't you?
Yeah, played here last year and I think it's settled down a lot with the extra year of growth into the green. So really, I think it's a really good ball strikers course because it is windy and you've got to be really precise with your shots into the green. So I think it'll suit those guys, which I like. So hopefully it'll be a good week.
Now, we have an excellent field assembled here this week. We obviously have Adam Scott, Mark Leishman, Ian Poulter. Would you like to see yourself setting up a weekend tee time with one of those guys?
Sure would. I guess that's what you play for, and it'd be great to be able to get out there on the weekend and have a late tee time and be a chance to win such a great trophy.
All right, excellent. Well, we wish you the best of luck at the Australian PGA Championship and with the award this evening, and we'll let you go and enjoy the rest of the night.
Thanks, Liv.
Thank you. Ash Hall, thanks for joining us here at the Greg Norman Medal, nominated for the 2016 PGA Tour of Australasia Player of the Year. A great honour to be nominated tonight.
Yeah, for sure. It was very shocking and that, but I suppose last week's result was good. I I thought after winning the Vic PGA, I thought, I might have a chance to be nominated or something if I keep doing well. And through the middle of the year, kind of wasn't so good. But, it's going all right now.
All right, well, we'll touch on the start of the year before we move on to last week. Vic PGA, you won that tournament at Huntingdale, where you grew up playing. And it was in a playoff as well over David McKenzie, I believe.
Yeah, I've got a thing about playoffs. Two of my wins have been in playoffs, and I've lost, I think, five now in playoffs. But that's fine. On the Australian tour anyway, I've lost a few more overseas in playoffs. But it's fun, and it meant a lot. Huntingdale was very good, and we've been in some dark spots, but it's all looking good now.
Yeah, I was going to say, it was a very special win at Huntingdale. It was an emotional one as well. Can you take us back to what was going through your mind and just how much it meant to you, but also to your family?
Just because it was Huntingdale meant some more as well. The members and stuff like that there, it's a part of me. But I had to do Q school at the start of the year as well, and I thought, it was possibly done. And, I hadn't won for quite a while, so quite a lot of years. But it showed me that I can do well again and win again, and it kept my belief all year, really.
All right, now let's go to the Australian Open, and you're in the three-way playoff with Jordan Spieth and also with Cam Smith. Can you talk us through the playoff, what was going through your mind on that first tee shot?
Oh, the tee shot was really good because for some reason they weren't letting the crowd back to the tee, so it was just us. It was nice and quiet, and just us with the TV camera and stuff. It was quite good. And then once we got down to where our tee shots went, the crowd 6 or 7 deep, and it's a pretty good spot, the 18th at Royal Sydney. And there's lots of things shouted from the crowd, which kind of spurred us on. And I've got a new nickname during that playoff as well, which is kind of funny. So it was really fun.
All right, you can't brush over that without telling us what the nickname is.
My nickname's the other guy. A lot of people in the crowd were enjoying themselves, and it was, kind of go Jordan, go Cam, go the other guy. A few people knew who I was too, so that was okay.
All right, now talk us through when you approach a green and you obviously saw Jordan's shot and your shot, they were similar range, and then he sinks his putt. How much pressure then goes onto you?
It was a lot. My hands were shaking and what have you, but that was fine. I absolutely knew 100% he was going to make it. I really thought his shot was a lot closer from the fairway. We couldn't see the level of the green, and to see mine closer was kind of cool. And everyone keeps telling me this last week that it was such a good chance and it was so close, which it was. It was great. It's all good really in the end.
Now, you mightn't have walked away with the Stonehaven Cup, but you have a chance at winning the Claret Jug. You've made it into the Open thanks to your performance at the Australian Open.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm going to really enjoy it now, the second time that I'm playing that tournament. So I know what it's all about, and I've played Birkdale quite a bit actually. So it's going to be good fun, and we can share it a lot with the family. Everyone says they're coming already, so we've got quite the travelling party already.
Now, coming back to this evening and the Player of the Year award, how do you rate your chances?
I can't see how Blythe is not going to win, to be honest. Two wins is pretty good. People don't quite realise, I think, how hard it is to win. So if I was voting, that's the way I'd be voting. But I'm pretty proud to be nominated still.
All right. Well, we'll let you go and enjoy the evening. Best of luck, and we'll maybe see you later.
Awesome. Yeah, cheers. Thank you.
Thanks, Ash. And I'm joined here by Michael Hendry, who's flying the New Zealand flag proudly this evening. Our only Kiwi nominee for the 2016 PGA Tour of Australasia Player of the Year. What does it mean to be representing the Kiwis here this evening?
Oh, it's nice for us to be counted every now and then. I was quite surprised and obviously really honoured to have the nomination. So, really excited to be here.
Got off to a great start of the season. Had two top five finishes at the New Zealand events. How important is it to you to be playing well on home soil?
Oh, hugely important. It's really important for the New Zealand public too. I don't know how many times I hear, when is the Kiwi going to win the New Zealand Open? Because it's been so long. And, we all want it so bad. That's probably why none of us have won it for such a long period of time. But you know, just for the New Zealand golfing public to realise that we do have some pretty decent players out there doing a pretty good job, and I think potentially they don't see enough of it back home. So you know, to play well on home ground is not only really satisfying for me as a player, but also really satisfying for a lot of New Zealand golfing fans.
So when are we going to see a New Zealand win the New Zealand Open? Obviously, you've been playing very well, and Ryan Fox just got his European Tour card. There's a lot of talent in New Zealand at the moment.
Oh, look, I think there's plenty of depth in New Zealand golf at the moment. I think potentially the only thing that holds maybe the New Zealand golfers back a little bit is not realising how good they are. Like, they've just got to get out there and prove to themselves, I think, is probably the biggest thing. And hopefully it won't be too long where we'll see, you know, a Kiwi lifting that New Zealand Open trophy.
Now, you had an excellent year playing on the Japan Tour, and you came very close to representing New Zealand at the Olympics. It was only a couple of world ranking spots in it. Was that a disappointment? Bittersweet, because I'm sure you're happy for Ryan as well.
Oh, look, me and Ryan are really good mates, and we spend a lot of time together outside of tournament weeks and playing golf with friends and stuff like that. So we know each other really well, and it's sort of one of those situations where we're both playing really well and we're both pushing each other harder to do well out on tour. So, you know, obviously it would have been great to represent New Zealand at the Olympics. There's another one in 4 years' time. Hopefully I'll be there or thereabouts again at that one. But, you know, I played really, really good golf during that lead-up to that selection for the Olympics. And I've got to take my hat off to Ryan for pushing me that hard to play that well during that period of time. So, you know, sure, I missed out and it would have been a great experience, but you know, I've had a fantastic year, and I like I say, I've got to take my hat off to Ryan for pushing me hard to really get those results.
Now, can you talk me through your year in Japan? Because obviously it can be a challenging tour for internationals to play on, but you've had an outstanding season.
Yeah, look, it's been really, really good. Other than I've done pretty much everything I could other than win a tournament up there this year. I've had 2 seconds. I think I had a run of about 7 top fives in a row during the middle of the year. So it's been a really exceptional year for me. And you know, other than last year where I had my first win up there last year, it was a bit inconsistent last year. So one of my goals this year was to be a lot more consistent. And obviously I would have liked to have won an event, but the consistency factor this year was right there. And, you know, a couple of changes I've made have obviously just made me a more consistent and better player. So, you know, really excited going forward and on that tour. And hopefully, you know, there'll be many more years like this year up there.
Now, coming back to the PGA Tour of Australasia, your highlight of the season was obviously finishing runner-up to Brant Snedeker at the Fiji International. That was a brilliant tournament for you. And does it give you a lot of confidence knowing that you're finishing runner-up to a top 20 player in the world?
Yeah, it does. I mean, and it's a great opportunity for us, you know, playing the Japanese Tour and the Australasian Tour, with the exception of the odd event, we don't really get to see the top players in the world. So it's great just to be able to know where you stand in comparison. And the fortunate thing for me, about 2 weeks later, I actually played with Brant in the Bridgestone Open in Japan. And I actually got up over him that day, which is, you know, fairly satisfying. But, you know, it just sort of gives you an idea of, you know, how much work you need to do in certain areas or how close you actually are to being able to compete with those guys day in and day out. And it's, you know, it's a lot of fun. And it does give you a lot of confidence when you're competing well against those guys who have achieved so much in the game.
Now, looking to this week at the Australian PGA Championship, you're looking for a big result. It would also see you secure the Order of Merit. What would that mean to you?
Oh, it would mean everything to me. I love playing the Australasian Tour. It's, you know, such a great tour to play. The events are always put on really well, and the golf courses are always magnificent. I just, you know, if I could play here year round and financially make it viable, I would. You know, I wouldn't travel anywhere else. I love this tour, and having the opportunity last year, I didn't play a lot of events, so I didn't actually have any status on the tour. And just the guys allowing me to have a couple of invites at the beginning of the year, you know, to then turn around and have the year I've had, you know, just, yeah, it means the world to me. It's, you know, I love playing on this tour, and, you know, just to secure myself on this tour for 5 years by winning the Order of Merit would be, yeah, it'd be awesome.
All right, well, we wish you the best of luck at the Australian PGA Championship and also with tonight's award, and we'll let you go and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Thanks, Liv.
Thank you. And I'm joined now by our final nominee for the PGA Tour of Australasia Player of the Year Award, Matthew Miller. Now, it's a special night. You could be going back-to-back. You also took out the top honour last year.
Yeah, it was an incredible thrill to win last year. Not as confident this year. I think there's probably been some players that have had some great seasons and, obviously, without naming names, some players that have won twice and so on, and some big tournaments. But I'm very happy to be, I guess, in the nominations, and that says that the year's been pretty good, so I'm very happy with that.
Now, has it been nice to walk around tournaments all year saying I'm the player of the year? Is that, you know, a little one-up on maybe some of your travelling partners?
Oh, it is, yeah, for them. Yeah, it's great to be able to have that in your ammunition, but... Yeah, I mean, many events that you've been to, that title is thrown around, and I guess even a lot of pro-am events as well, not just our tour events. So I'd be lying if I said I haven't enjoyed it. It has been great, it's been an honour and a privilege. So.
And a lot of benefits that have come your way this year from having played so well last year. You recently just played in a WGC event.
Yeah. Great to finally play a WGC. Awesome tournament in Shanghai, European Tour, US Tour, best players in the world. I didn't play as well as I would have liked that week, but it was great to have that opportunity to be able to compete with them, walk past them, share lockers next to McIlroy. Great to have a surname starting with him. Matsuyama right there, Molinari, but... so it was great to get in and play that event, and I've had a couple other invites as well, which has been great, and I've sort of made the most of them.
Now, the key to a long and successful career in golf is consistency. We like to call you Mr. Consistent. Was it nice to see that you came back out on tour this year and put in another good performance after your efforts last year?
Yeah, it was. I was actually very worried about how it had pan out at the start, how I'd back that up. And I just came out with the thoughts that I'd just go through it again, do exactly what I thought worked, and I got off to a good start. All good things must come to an end. I guess I missed the cut in Perth, and I've had some good events, and I've had some opportunities to win this year, and I haven't, which has probably bugged me a little bit. It was great to start as well as I did and have some great results, but I really would like to finish off big this week, so...
All right, well, I think we're about to get back underway with the awards. So I wish you well this week at the Australian PGA Championship. Good luck tonight in trying to defend your Player of the Year honours, and we'll let you enjoy the rest of the evening.
Great. Thanks for having us. Thank you.
And how about a round of applause for Trace, playing some outstanding, tuneful toe-tappers. Well done, guys. We'll look forward to seeing you back here a little later on. To our next award, I'm delighted to welcome Hugh Dolan, Legends Tour Committee member, to present the Easy Go Legends Tour Player of the Year Award.
Jim, how are you, mate? I'm
watching the tournament.
Chairman?
Yes.
Oh, that's great.
Thanks very much. It's my pleasure on behalf of the Easy Go Legends Tour players to announce the winner of the Legends Tour Player this year. It's a new event for 2016, which is a real thrill for all the Legends Tour players. The nominees are Mike Harwood, David Hando, and Dave Merriman, and Tim Elliott. And I have great pleasure in announcing that Tim Elliott is the winner.
Currently leading the 2016 Order of Merit for the EasyGo Legends Tour, Elliott has achieved 7 wins and 37 top 10 finishes in the 12-month period counting towards the Player of the Year. Amongst those wins is the Vuksic and Boric Fiji Legends Golf Classic. During his career, the 54-year-old counts 2 wins on the ISPS Handa PGA Tour of Australasia and winning the 2014 EasyGo Legends Tour Order of Merit. Amongst his best achievements.
It's a great pleasure to accept this on Tim's behalf. Unfortunately, Tim, due to playing commitments, was unable to be here tonight, but I'm sure he'll be absolutely thrilled to win this award. Thanks very much.
Hugh, thank you. Of course, Hugh is the chairman of the Legends Tour Player Council. To announce the Player of the Year for the ALPG, would you please welcome Shani Waugh?
It's my pleasure to present the ALPG Player of the Year Award. The nominees for the ALPG Player of the Year have been shortlisted following criteria around results, consistency and event played on the Australian Ladies Professional Golf Tour. Nominees are Catherine Bristow from New Zealand, Lauren Hibbert, Stacey Keating and Kari Webb. And the winner is Stacey Keating.
...2016 was a strong year for Keating, winning four times on the ALPG Tour, including the Anita Boone Pro-Am, the Bingley Oatlands Pro-Am, Brisbane International, and the BWAC Yamba Pro-Am. These finishes resulted in her winning the ALPG Clubcast Series. The 30-year-old Victorian also finished second on the ALPG Order of Merit in 2016. Keating's performance also stretched across the waters, with strong finishes on the Ladies European Tour, in the Tipsport Masters, and the World Ladies Championship in China.
It's my pleasure to accept the award on Stacey's behalf. She's actually in Japan with the Australian, with the ALPG team, about to play in the Queen's Cup. She did email me a couple of words. Normally she'd say a lot more than this. For those of you that know Stacey, she likes to chat. But she probably wants you to get on and have a great evening as well, so her speech is quite short. Thank you so much to the ALPG and the PGA for choosing me for this award. It's a huge honour. I love coming home to play in the ALPG summer. It's something I look forward to every year, and to play well is just a bonus. Congratulations to all of the other winners this evening, and good luck to the boys this week. Thank you.
Shani, thank you, and we congratulate Stacey Keating as the ALPG Player of the Year. Now going to invite the Chairman of the PGA, Mr. Peter O'Malley, to come forward to present the ISPS Honda PGA Tour of Australasia Player of the Year.
Thank you very much. The ISP Honda PGA Player of the Year Award, we have a short list of nominees. There's Adam Bly, Ashley Hall, Michael Hendry, Matthew Griffin and Matthew Miller. And I'm pleased to announce the winner is Adam Bly.
...35-year-old Adam Blythe from Queensland got his season off to a hot start, leading the Oates Vic Open into the final round. A tough fourth round dropped him down the leaderboard, but he proved the perfect learning experience to launch a very successful season. Blythe recorded his first win on the ISPS Honda PGA Tour of Australasia this September at the South Pacific Open Championship in New Caledonia. Just three starts later, he quickly added a second victory at the New South Wales Open in a hard-fought fourth round. Adam has played 13 tournaments this season, making the cut nine times.
He also wins Best Dressed of the Night Award too, looking very sharp indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, a very special part of the night. Would you please welcome to the stage Mr. Peter Senior.
Good evening, everybody. I'd personally like to thank the PGA very much for bestowing this honour of presenting this next award. Tonight we honour one of Australia's greatest sportsmen and golfers, Peter Thompson, whose achievements in golf have left a legacy like no other. On the course, Peter, his achievements include 89 professional wins, 5 British Opens, 2 Canada Cup wins with Kel Nagel, 10 different national titles in 10 different countries, a US PGA Seniors Championship in 1985, and he's the only captain of a winning International President's Cup team. Peter continued to shape the game following his playing career. Some of his remarkable contributions include a successful course design career, developing more than 180 courses in 30 different countries. He authored books, magazine articles, and newspaper columns around the globe. He was instrumental in the development of the Holden Scramble, now celebrating 25 years, and remains Australia's longest running and most successful pro amateur team event. He served as president of the PGA for 32 years. Ongoing industry and charitable work resulting in being honoured a member of the Order of the British Empire in 1957, Commander of the British Empire in 1979, and an Officer of the Order of Australia in 2001. Peter was inducted into the Australian Sporting Golf Hall of Fame in 1985 and the World Golf Hall of Fame in 1988. Above all, Peter Thompson epitomises the value of importance of the PGA, continuing to inspire golfers around the world. A life member of the PGA, tonight we honour Peter as the first PGA immortal, a deserving title for a great man.
PGA of Australia Immortal Award than Peter Thompson. Peter is one of the true greats of the game and an outstanding ambassador for golf. It is remarkable to consider the level of dominance he achieved in the Open in the 1950s and early 1960s. From 1952 to 1958, he did not finish outside of the top two in golf's oldest championship. You only have to listen to Peter and see the glint in his eyes as he shares his experiences of playing at the very highest level to realize that he is a truly special person.
I think people might be surprised to know just how much Peter Thompson has influenced my career, considering, you know, we're a couple generations apart. I actually caddied for Peter Thompson when I was 10 years old, when he opened a golf course on the Sunshine Coast that he'd designed. He walked a whole practice round with me at the 2000 Open Championship, my first ever major, and at St Andrews, and guided me around the course. He had just such a simple way of doing things. He was so naturally gifted, and he wasn't caught up in all the stuff that there is now with the game. And I think sometimes for me that's a great lesson, to think about how he explains things in its simplest form. And it's just not that, he never found it that difficult, and that's a good thing to think of.
I've known Peter Thompson for a long time. I had some of my greatest matches against him, played him in the final of the PGA. That's Huntingdale. I'm happy to say I beat him on the last green after 36 holes. He was a highly intelligent man and did an awful lot for golf. He went into politics. He was a man who was well read, and he had, without a question, I think, the greatest record of any Australian golfer that ever lived. I mean, he was not only a golfer, he was a true ambassador to the game. So all in all, the PGA have chosen an outstanding man.
He deserves every honour he's ever received. He's an incredible golfer to win the Open Championship 5 times. So I'm very happy for Peter.
On behalf of the RNA and everyone here in St Andrews, I would like to warmly congratulate Peter on this thoroughly deserved recognition and convey our very best wishes to him and his wife, Mary.
Thank you.
Mary, you have been elected spokesperson tonight. Yes. I know you will do, as always, an outstanding job.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Mary, part of Team Thompson, and I'll speak on Peter's behalf because much as he loves a microphone, his health now precludes public speaking. Before I read the letter Peter has written, I would like to tell you that yesterday we visited Ian Stanley, who's a valued member of the PGA and a great charity worker. For those here tonight who know Ian, and perhaps also for those who do not, Ian is playing the biggest competition of his life. He's relentless in his fight against cancer and is showing the spirit and fortitude one always holds in awe. We saw him in Cabrini Palliative Care, but the good news is that today Pam will be taking him home again. Would you all wish them both well with a round of applause? Thank you for that, because I wanted to say, please wish them well with a round of applause that we can relay to them on our return to Melbourne. I'll now read Peter's letter to you all. Dear everyone present, am I not a lucky man? Most people have nice things said about them at their funerals when it's too late for their own enjoyment. But you've all jumped the gun, as it were, and given this lovely tribute for me to hear. This award, the immortal, if it works, may mean I'll never need a funeral. Now to be serious, I thank you all sincerely. Peter O'Malley, Chairman, Brian Thorburn, CBO, Peter Senior, and all the board members of the PGA, indeed every member of our association. I am most truly thrilled to be recognised and honoured by my peers of this great association. As many of you here present tonight know, the PGA has been a huge part of my life since I was 19 years old. In those days, it was mandatory to serve a 2-year apprenticeship before being properly admitted. So I went to work for George Naismith at Riversdale Golf Club in Melbourne. George was a most generous man, and during that 2-year period, he allowed me to go to the few events that were held in Australia. The first one was the Australian Open in Adelaide, and I was thrilled to achieve second place. Apprenticeship completed, I set off overseas to gain experience, and at that time, Norman von Nieder played a large role with help and advice. My travel certainly enlarged my horizons, and I met many interesting people. Success came slowly but sweetly, and I like to say, in fairness, that I have always felt I never worked a day in my life. Such was the pleasure and challenge this wonderful game of golf provided. To become president of the PGA in the 60s was a huge thrill, and my 32 years in that role were tremendously rewarding. At last, I felt I was giving something back to an association that had given me so much. I have had a fortunate life. Now I'm 87 years old. Mary and I have a son and 3 daughters. We have 11 grandchildren and 2 great-granddaughters. They all surround us with love and support, so I have a great deal to be thankful for. Finally, I would like to say something about the unsung heroes, mostly unsung heroes, of our PGA. They are the men, and the now women too, who run our pro shops at clubs and courses all around our country. They teach and toil for long hours, and they nurture this splendid game in the young and old who pass their way. Without their dedication, where would our game be? So I pay them a heartfelt tribute. Yours sincerely, Peter Thompson.
Perfect.
Good night.
That is a class act, isn't it? Team Thompson. Well done, Mary. Thank you for reading that letter on behalf of Peter, who becomes an immortal of the PGA. I had the privilege of working at the World Cup of Golf at Kingston Heath last week, and on the first tee, we had Justin, the head of golf down there. He's a lovely bloke. And there's this young fellow, he's about this tall, who was looking after the honorary observers. And it is a tough job. And he was going about it diligently and lovely attitude and nature. And when we ran out of bananas on the first, he was off to get them, teas. Just did a great job. I hadn't really met him before, and chatting away on Saturday, and I said, "Now, Lachlan, how did you get this job?" He said, "I got roped into it." I said, "Well, yeah, you're doing a fantastic job, young man, and do you play golf?" I thought he might have been like a cadet at the club. And he said, no, he said, "My grandfather played a bit." It was Peter's grandson, Lachlan. What a lovely young man. And I said to Peter and Mary, it was great to see Peter on the 18th there at Kingston Heath on Sunday afternoon as the players came up and we presented the trophy, to see him there as part of the official party. But I said that he's a very, very nice young man. Well, speaking of international events, we've had some of our greatest golfers representing Australia in international events. And to that end, I'm going to invite Olympians and World Cup representatives who are in the room here at Royal Pines tonight. So from Rio de Janeiro, let's welcome Ian Baker Finch and Marcus Fraser. Come on, gentlemen. And speaking of the World Cup, what a great event it was at Kingston Heath last week, and the two players that proudly represented Australia. Let's welcome Adam Scotts and Mark Leishman.
We brought you the stool for you. Have a seat. Have a seat, Ivy. Thank you.
It's like a segment from Australia's Most Wanted. Only joking. Ian, I'll start with you.
Because I'm the oldest.
No, you're the best looking. Tell me about the road to Rio and how the golf event was perceived for the first time in Olympic history.
It was a difficult road, I must say. The media didn't help. No offence to anyone here. It's not anyone in the media's problem here, but in general, it was a difficult time getting it to be thought of in the way that it's thought of now, to be honest with you. Sure. It was a tough 2 years, but the 3 weeks that I spent in Rio with Marcus and Hendy and Minji and Sue were three of the best weeks of my life, and I think golf is now very highly regarded. When you mention golf in the Olympics,
yeah.
I think it's going to be great in Tokyo, and I think it'll be in there for a long time to come.
Marcus, to be an Olympian, was that something you ever thought about as a young man?
Not a chance. I think, growing up in a small country town in Corowa, and then all of a sudden, this year in Rio, being over there and competing for Australia at the Olympics is, it was beyond my wildest dreams, and, just feel very fortunate that I had the chance to go over there and have that experience, because it's something for my kids to later on in life, for them to be able to say that their old man went to the Olympics. It's pretty cool for me to be able to say that about me, and it's something I'll never forget.
How about Olympic record holder, Dad? Huh? How about that? Olympic record holder, Marcus Fraser, 63, round one.
Unbelievable.
Was there a different feel to the event as an Olympic event as opposed to playing in a tournament?
Absolutely. I think golf's obviously such a selfish sport. We're out there week in, week out for ourselves and our families. But I think to get there, I think I was a little bit naive going into it, assuming that it's just going to be any old week that you turn up and play a golf tournament and you try compete and do as best as you possibly can. And then to get there and the whole week just gathered legs, I think, and you start to appreciate how big a deal it actually is. And to be part of a bigger team, not only the team that you have week in, week out, but then to be out there representing Australia and be part of that as along with 400 other athletes was pretty cool.
Well, guys, the World Cup, again, fantastic event. Did you really enjoy yourselves over those 4 days, Scotty?
Absolutely. Yeah, playing Kingston Heath, one of the best tracks in the world, is always enjoyable. Leash and I just didn't play good enough last week. Don't know what was wrong with us out there. But it's a great event. It was great that it was back on again. It had been without it for 3 years since Jason and I won it. A new format, maybe spark a bit of life back into it and carry on in the prestigious fashion it's been held in the past.
Mark, how did you feel when you got the call up? How did you find out that you were going to be playing in the World Cup?
I got a nice text off Scotty. Jace was actually coming to my, I was at his foundation's golf day and he wasn't able to play and he came to mine but wasn't able to play and I just sort of shot Scotty off a text and I'm like, look, if Jace can't make it, love to be there. and then a couple of weeks later, Scotty contacted me and he said, are you good to go? And I'm like, well, yeah, I think I'll be able to make it. So we got there. Great feeling to represent Australia. First time I've done it as a professional, and I guess like Scotty said last week a few times, we feel like we're representing Australia every week on the tour.
Sure.
But representing the President's Cup team is a little bit different to representing Australia in your virtually your hometown in front of your home crowd. So it was a huge honour, and obviously a little disappointing that we couldn't play a little better and have that trophy here with us now. But it was a huge honour and a fun week. Obviously playing with a good friend of mine, a lot of laughs out there, and just had a good time.
Let me ask the four of you, is that you guys play individually on tour, etc. But when you get into a team's event, Olympics and the World Cup, you really see that camaraderie that surrounds the sport of golf come out, don't you? You go first, IBF. You probably got no idea what I'm talking about.
Well, it would. I've had the great opportunity to be a part of representing this country. Every time we go out and play, and Adam and I had a great discussion earlier in the year about, he said, Finchy, I represent Australia every time I go out and play golf. And every one of these guys here does. Peter Thompson was a great leader and mentor of mine and so many of us here in the room, and he did the same thing for all of those years overseas. And there's so many international golfers in here and so many other PGA professionals. That's what we do. We represent Australia every time we step out on the golf course. And I just had the opportunity to be alongside Peter Thompson and the great Gary Player many times at President's Cup. And then this time to be bestowed the honour of being a part of the Olympics for the first time in so many years.
Sure.
And to have that chance to put on the green and gold and to represent Australia and be a part of something that's greater than us, it was just an amazing time. To play World Cup when I did was fantastic, but just to be alongside these youngsters and see how great they really are and how good the game is and how I think we're in good hands going forward with guys like this,
Absolutely.
Representing us around the world.
Scott, Adam, you talked about the format of the World Cup. Have they got it right, do you think? I know you guys have probably talked about it.
I don't know. I mean, I'm happy with it. I think it's much better as a team event where you're playing with your partner. That was the most fun part for Mark and I last week. when I won with Jason, I didn't play one round of golf with him for the whole week, and we won the event as a team. So that was a lot more fun. I don't know, there's always bits to work out. I mean, sure. The qualification seems a bit strange that guys are in and then they're out, and then I'm picking him, and if I don't play, he might be picking someone else. It's a bit confusing, but I think they'll work that out, and when they do, I think it's a good opportunity to have another kind of event at this time of year, an event with some importance in a team format. There's so much very serious golf all year long that it's nice to break it up with something like this. The Ryder Cup does that every couple of years. The President's Cup does it every couple of years. I think there's room for one more event like that.
Well, even apart from the Olympics, is there room for another event such as these, do you think? Or is the calendar too full?
It's a balancing act. I guess everyone out here, the people who enjoy watching golf, will tell us if there is or not, because, you know, not every event can be the Open Championship or the Masters or the Australian Open or whatever, or the Australian PGA. It's all very, very serious stuff. But we also have to showcase golf as well, and whether the World Cup's treated as a serious event or just showcasing some of the best players playing together in a different format, I think there's room for all that. But there is a lot of golf out there.
It's
always hard finding a date for a new tournament, and where's the best time, and when can you get the guys to commit? That's the challenges that all the organisations who run events face.
Yeah, if you take the World Cup of golf to iconic golf courses like Kingston Heath, to great nations, golfing nations around the world. You don't think Scotland can't find an iconic course to hold the World Cup, or England, or any of the great golfing nations, obviously the United States, Canada, where the Canada Cup started. I think it's a wonderful opportunity, and to really maybe figure out how the Olympic competition should be fought. Let's figure it out through the World Cup.
Yeah.
Leading into that every 4 years. This is the best way. Everyone seemed to... I wouldn't mind seeing maybe a mixed format, not the World Cup necessarily, but maybe the Men's World Cup and the Women's World Cup. Maybe they can find a way every 4 years to get together at Olympic time. Something like that. But I agree with not being a part of golf anymore as a player, just seeing it, you know, from above or as a part of it. I think we need team competition, and I think the Canada Cup, now the World Cup, has been a big part of that, and I'd like to see it continue in a serious format, but you know, have fun as teams like Peter Thompson and Kel Nagel used to do all those years ago, and Arnold Palmer and Jack Nicklaus did for all those times that they played together, Freddie Couples and Davis Love. You don't think they weren't having fun representing their country? And I think that's how it should be.
Marcus, let's go back to the course in Rio. Obviously it was very much to your liking, but tell us about the course itself. Sort of glimpses on the television, and I was watching it over there, but my Portuguese is sadly lacking. Couldn't understand. I think he said that was a birdie, but I'm not sure.
Obviously a purpose-built golf course for the Olympics, and I think Gil Hans did a great job. It was a big wide-open fairways that created angles into the greens, and I think if the greens had maybe a little bit firmer, it would have... The strategy would have come into it a lot more. The greens were quite soft and took a lot of the strategy out of it. But at the same time, I thought it was for a purpose-built golf course, it was very Melbourne-like. The bunker lines were very similar to the Sandbelt golf courses. Obviously, there's a lot of bunkering and the slopes around the greens came into it massively. It would have obviously been nice to if it was a little firmer and the ball would actually react the same way as what it does on the Sandbelt golf courses. But for a purpose-built golf course, in a country like Brazil that's not famous for its golf,
sure.
I thought it was a fantastic golf course, and not only because I had a good first day there, but I thought it was a proper golf course that in wind and you could see if it was firm, it would be a real challenge out there and a lot of strategy involved.
Now, life in the village, mate, for an Olympian. Did you ring Kitty Chiller to tell her you were going out and then ring her when you had to come home?
No, I didn't. I didn't get a chance to catch up with anyone who stayed in the village. We're in a house about 10 minutes from the course.
You've done it beautifully.
It was lovely. We were obviously very fortunate to stay in the house, and we also we we're about 15, 20 minutes from the village and went in and had a look and had dinner in there a couple of nights and sort of got to rub shoulders with a few of the athletes and have a look around. And it was, you know, obviously a huge complex and I think around 12,000 athletes in the village. So it was a pretty surreal experience to be a part of that and think that you're wearing the Australian colours through the village.
Fantastic.
There and be part of it all.
The food was a little better in the house, do you think?
As you can probably see, I enjoy my food. And
We had steak 11 nights in a row. Yeah.
We had steak 11 nights out of 10 nights, I think.
We had steak for breakfast, for whatever was left over, we had steak. But the house was a great environment. When I started out on the Rio thing, I wanted everyone to be a part of the team. And the guys have talked about that, how special it is to be a part of the team in an environment such as that. And I wanted it to be like a major championship where the guys show up with their family and their trainer and their team around them, and hence the house. I said to the guys when we're making all the arrangements, let's get a house. We can all be in the house. We can be one team. The trainers can be there, the caddies, the players. Myself, Brad James from Golf Australia was the assistant captain. He was there with me.
Must have been a bloody big house.
But it was, yeah, it was. It was an unbelievable house. And the cooking was exceptional. If I do say so myself. We went out to steak places every night.
It's all they eat over there,
isn't it? Really, it was really, really good. And great environment. And I think my job was to make sure that we created an environment that allowed the players to play the best they possibly could.
Can.
And that's what we did.
Well done. Well, fellas, not far away from the announcement of the Greg Norman Medal for 2016. Looking forward to the next few days here, Adam, back at home.
I'm home this week. It's fantastic for me, staying at home. And good memories of playing the event here the last couple of times I was here, winning in 13 and coming so close in 14 and losing out in a big playoff. Although that's not a great memory, still lots of good vibes around this golf course, so looking forward to getting stuck into it this week.
Leesh, what about you, my friend? Ready to go?
Yeah, definitely ready to go. I feel like both Scotty and myself are pretty close to some good stuff. And there was some good stuff last week, just a little bit too much bad stuff. But excited about this week. It's a great way to finish off the year. It's such a... The Gold Coast has so much to offer. And my family's here this week. They can enjoy it while I'm on the golf course. And, all the new stuff at the pool here. It's a great week for me and a great week for them. So that's, hopefully it'll all bode for a really, really happy end to the year and a great tournament.
Great stuff. Now, Marcus, you've just moved house. That's a fairly stressful arrangement. Come up here and play a bit of golf. Get away from all that unpacking.
Yeah, hopefully it's all set up by the time I get home. That'd be nice. I'm not sure how you found that out, but...
You told me in the foyer this afternoon.
You haven't got the address, have you?
No, that definitely.
I'll make sure I empty the fridge before you get there. I'm obviously, my wife and kids are coming up tomorrow night.
Terrific.
My parents arrived this afternoon. As it always is, the Australian PGA is such a great championship. And, at the back end of the year, we obviously all, and Australians, we want to win our national championship. And, it's great that every year the Australian PGA creates such a family-friendly environment for all of the players when we come back to, as we love supporting the tournament because it is our national championship and we love it to bits.
Not a dinosaur in sight. Well, except for Finchie. Mate, I've got to compliment you. Your commentary is outstanding. I just love it. I will confess that I have the $110 a month channel at home to watch all the golf and some of the commentary drives me to distraction. And then I hear the voice of reason, those dulcet tones, and I go, thank God he's there. We're going to hear somebody who's actually going to make some sense throughout the commentary. Are you enjoying it?
I do, and it's a great way for me to stay involved in the game. It's been two decades now since I played. I still play okay. Can shoot in the 60s occasionally. But it's just allowed me to stay close to all the youngsters, probably keeps me young. One of the saddest days I can think of was Pete Senior retiring the other day at the Australian Open. That was a sad day for me and a sad day for golf in Australia. Been a great mate for 40 years. Fortunately, he was a year older than me, so every second year I got to win the Queensland Schoolboy Championships because I didn't have to compete against him. all of the guys used to love it if, you know, if they win a different age group to Pete Senior, you had a chance of winning something. But if you're in the same age group as Pete Senior, you always ran second or worse. So, yeah, it's a great gig for me. It's really, it keeps me close. And I think everyone here in Australia listens into the US broadcasts, and it's kind of pleasant to hear somebody that you know and hear a voice of reason, as you say, someone that's played the game and a voice you can trust.
Well, that is certainly Ian Baker Finch. Gentlemen, thank you for joining us. Enjoy. I know you will enjoy the time here at Royal Pines at the PGA Australia Championship. And thank you to Mark Leishman, of course, to Adam Scott, world number seven, the voice of reason, and to Marcus as well. We have reached the denouement of our evening here tonight at Royal Pines on the eve of the PGA Championship of Australia. It is time now to announce the 2016 Greg Norman medalist. And joining me on the stage, would you please welcome back Chairman of the PGA, Mr. Peter O'Malley. Peter, you can feel the excitement building. We are going to announce the winner of the 2016 Greg Norman Medal. You're here. The great man isn't here, but he's going to join us. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Mr. Greg Norman.
Hey, good evening, Craig, and good morning, Mr. Chairman. And well, I shouldn't say, well, good evening to you. Good morning for us. It's in the wee hours of the morning here. But first of all, I want to say thank you to the PGA Tour and the PGA of Australia for the second annual Greg Norman Medal Awards Dinner. It's been a great honor for me to have this medal named after me, and everybody in this room tonight has been very instrumental into my career to where I've gotten to, where I am today. So I really do appreciate it. I apologize I could not be there tonight. Obviously, schedules are very, very difficult to do that, but at the end of the day, I know you're going to have a magnificent night with the leadership of Craig there at the helm. And to you, Chairman O'Malley, thank you for your great leadership that you're doing with the PGA and everything that's happening in Australia. So it's been a phenomenal year across the board for all Australian professional golfers. And we just welcome everybody tonight, and I look forward to announcing this year's winner.
Greg, it's in your hands, my friend.
Well, look, it's the three nominees this year have done a very, very impressive job on the golf course. And I want to say equally impressive job off the golf course. Everybody takes it for granted because they can swing 14 clubs extremely well. But the responsibilities that come with the success on the golf course are equal off the golf course. And every one of the three nominees tonight have done a fantastic job of balancing their responsibilities, not only for the sport of golf, but for their country in Australia, for themselves individually, and their families. So our three nominees are Minji Lee, Jason Day, and Adam Scott. And I just want to say the winner tonight is a very extremely impressive performance this year is Jason Day.
Well done. Going to invite Jason's mum, Denning, to the stage, and his sister, Yana. And let's have a look at the year of Jason Day in 2016.
286 yards, wind off the left.
That might be going right out the flank.
It's
a shot. Yeah, I enjoyed that one.
That's one of the best of the day.
A glorious shot from Jason Day.
Shade
to the run he went on late last year.
Look at this. Turned a bogey shot into a birdie shot.
Wow. How good is that?
I mean, that's perfection.
Jason Day gets it done. In the end, it is Jason Day.
And Denning is going to proudly accept the Greg Norman Medal from Peter O'Malley. And it does suit her. Denning, come over here. Yana, you come over too. Come and have a quick chat. Come on. Actually, take hold of that. Come over next to me. And I want you to say, you ready for this? I want you to say, hello, Jason.
Hello, Jason. Hey!
Jason, congratulations. I think we've still got Greg on the line. Greg, here's your chance to congratulate the man who's won his second Greg Norman Medal.
Hey, Jason. Good morning to you up in Ohio, buddy. I know it's probably a little bit chillier up there than where it is in Australia and here in Florida. But, mate, congratulations. You've been a incredible performer on the world stage for the last couple of years, and holding your world number one title since March is equally impressive as far as I'm concerned. So what this year did you think was your best performance on the golf course?
There was so many great performances, but you know, looking back at it, probably the Players' Championship, just really knowing that my best finish there has been a tied six before this year, and you know, sitting there thinking that I really typically don't play well around TPC, and then finally coming up with a game plan where decided to take the driver out of my hand for the most part, and you know, we had tremendous weather that week, and to be able to hit two iron around that golf course and really, you know, strike it well enough to get it out there far enough to give myself the opportunities, but also hit enough fairways where I would give myself the opportunities to make birdies and you know, take, the first day and shoot nine under and go all the way through and win wide to wide was pretty special.
Well, saying to take your two iron out there and getting out there far enough is an understatement. You hit that thing like 280, 290. So that's like a driver in most people's hands anyway.
Yeah, no, I don't know, for some reason it just kind of worked out that way, whereas, like I said, it was really nice, warm conditions, and to be able to get that two iron out there, that's probably why I got a sore back, is that I'm going at it too hard. And, you know, unfortunately, that's just part and parcel of playing golf. And, you know what, I had a great performance. Obviously, I would like to, you know, finish the year off strong. You know, it was a little bit of a disappointment with having to pull out of the last two events and really kind of take my name out of winning the FedEx Cup. But, you know, that's just what happens with these injuries. They pop up every now and then. But, you know, not to say the least about, you know, what's going on with the start of the year and the middle part of my year. I played some tremendous golf going off of, you know, last year's performance. So once again, I'm really appreciative of, you know, everyone's efforts back home in Australia. Obviously, with this dinner, my mum, Yana there, Ian, my agent down there as well, the chairman, Peter O'Malley, the PGA of Australia. I just want to thank everyone, and especially you, Greg, obviously for, you know, what you've done for the game in Australia and around the world as well. So I just want to thank everyone there that made this possible for me.
Jason, Lucy's just celebrated her birthday, which is actually the day before your birthday. Who has the bigger party?
Definitely she does. you know, but that's good. You know, when we first had Lucy, I was actually glad she wished she was born on the 11th and not the 12th. You know, sometimes it's I don't want to sound full of myself, but you know, I just, you know, it's good that she has her own day.
Right.
And now that you know, that she's around, my birthday is kind of, it's second fiddle compared to hers. And you know, but that's just part and parcel of being a parent now. So, you know, very, very pleased and happy with how things have gone with Lucy. She's healthy and everything's going well. So it's hopefully one day she's in golf as well as Dash.
You talked about your year, but it's been some great highs. But physically, how are you feeling? And when do you think you're going to be back hitting golf balls seriously?
Yeah, obviously these things are frustrating because, you know, I was planning to come down to Australia and play, and, you know, obviously, you know, I miss Australia so much. I miss it like you wouldn't believe. I haven't been there for 3 years, and it's not going to be another year until I'm back. So it's going to be 4 years by the time I'm back, and it's been so long. And these last 3 years, twice now, injury has taken me out of getting down to Australia. Obviously, Lucy last year, but, you know, the year before that and this year. The back is coming along nicely. The hard thing about the position that I'm in, no matter what I do, I'm not going to please everyone, even with every decision I make. So, obviously, to miss playing in Australia is obviously... a disappointment to some, and I just got to understand that, you know, I'm in it for the long run. You know, that these things I have to take time and understand that when it comes to injuries, not to try and push myself too much, because I mean, we're looking at it right now. This week, Tiger Woods is coming back, and I think it's been 16 months but from the last time we saw him come back from, you know, kind of injury. So I'm okay with having a few months off, but 16 months off from golf, especially at a young age, I just can't do. So I've got to make sure I just look after myself, that I'm, you know, hopefully around for a very, very long time.
I think you've just given yourself the very best advice. Now, you've got a couple of words for Mum and Yana, who are here. Come over here. Come here, Danny. They miss you.
Yes. Yeah, I miss Mum. I actually saw Mum, you know, my mum actually saw Lucy for the first time this year. You know, obviously a month or 2 months back. I haven't seen Jan for a while, but Jan's actually, we've been trading texts and we've talked to each other for a bit. She's, I think she's becoming a golf coach, more of a mental coach. So,
I can hook you up now.
What's that, Jan?
I can hook you up with a good coach.
Oh, okay. I appreciate that. I just, I sometimes need a mental coach out there, Jan. So it's just, I always say that if you want to get into golf and make a lot of money, be a mental coach.
Mate, congratulations. It's been a huge night here. We'd love to see you back home. We'd love to see you just back playing some of the outstanding golf that we've enjoyed watching you play in 2016. Greg, I'm not sure if you're still there, but mate, we thank you for going to the effort to join us on your night, and I know that you will join with all of us here in the room in congratulating our 2016 Greg Norman medalist, Jason Day. Greg, thanks, mate. Thanks, Jason.
Thanks, Greg. Thanks, everybody.
Guys.
Thanks,
yes.
Guys.
Thanks, girls.
Well done. Well done. Look at that smile. And thoroughly deserved. Well done to Jason Day, his second Greg Norman medal. Well, folks, that's about it officially tonight. I'm sure that you will enjoy yourselves and the hospitality here at the PGA and our outstanding sponsors. Big Pro-Am tomorrow, and then the opening day, day one of the PGA Championship here on the Gold Coast. Enjoy the golf, and we'll see you on course. Thank you very much indeed.